average minus 50 degrees Fahrenheit constantly in the wintertime. And they have to just keep the channels going from Siberia on out. Now here's some of the pancake ice being formed together. You can see what it looks like. Doesn't look much different, you know, than a big snowstorm perhaps, but you can get an idea. This is the way it is all for these, for about 1,000 square miles. And this is a picture of the ship in total. Again, about 300 yards. Now, the thing about cutting through the ice, we were forewarned that the ice can be very, very loud, very noisy. For me, it was like being in a rougher Amtrak trip. But I love Amtrak trips, so it was no problem for me. And I loved the shaking and the moving, and the noise was like sometimes like two freight trains hitting, smashing into each other. They're cracking. Sometimes they'd have to back up and then come back again and smash through the ice. And it just sliced through everything. Just kept moving forward towards its appointed round, which was the pole. Oh. The ice again would be on the in this area here anywhere between 3 and 5 meters. Now here I am at the bow of the ship, and I have in my hand one of the Chinese people had a fishing rod, and I wanted to check the clarity of the water. It had 50 feet. And so I put some silvery little disc on it and threw it down into the water. And at this point, it's 10,000 feet deep. 10,000 feet deep. Well, that disc, you could see, I mean, it looked like it was an inch away. And in fact, you could see way beyond the disc. Now, you've all known about this business of places like in the Caribbean where the water is so clear, you could see everything. Well, the truth is, that means it's not very productive. It's when it's cloudy and it's filled with plankton and zooplankton that it's most productive. That's why swamps and places like that are the most productive foodstuffs. It's the beginning of the food cycle. Up here, it's a little brisk, obviously. You didn't see much birds or much animal life, other than we did see these seals. So there obviously was something here, enough for them to eat. Now, here we see, I showed you there was a helicopter. Let me just make it. There are two helicopters. Wait a minute, I'm jumping ahead here. Wait a minute. There, you see the helicopter up here? Right there? There are two helicopters which ferried us on and off the ice all the time. And of course, they don't have any American problems of people being chained up and, you know, you gotta watch everything. Nobody could get hurt anymore. Life has gotta be protected at all costs. The Russians couldn't care less. They left the doors open on the helicopters. I saved like 4 or 5 people who were so anxious to take pictures. They threw themselves at the open door. They weren't connected to anything. There was no tether. They were wild. The Russians thought it was a hilarious thing. People were going to throw themselves out of the helicopter. It was hilarious. Here's a picture from the helicopter. This is the open door of the helicopter. And it was really quite a sight to go up and down. It was another one. And to see the boat churning its way through. The Russian crewmen loved dealing with all the different nationalities. They loved showing them off, whatever they could show. Now, this brings up another picture. I showed you earlier that book, Mars High School and the Creation of the New York City Public High School System. This particular picture is of Donald Duncan. Donald Duncan was my bunkmate. Donald Duncan lives in Piscataway Forest, North Carolina. On the first day we met in Oslo, he introduced himself. I said hello, and he began asking me questions about the Bronx. Here I am in Oslo, and I wanted to talk Oslo. And he's talking about Pelham Parkway and coming across the Bronx River, and da-da-da-da. I'm just listening to him, and after a while he says, I lived in the Bronx, obviously, and it ended up, we went to the same high school together, 32 years apart. He's about 74 years old, retired now for some years, an inveterate traveler, great traveler. What are the odds that we would be assigned the same bunk? Two people from anywhere else? I mean, it's just an odd thing, one would think. I think you'd all agree. And here we were, sharing the same little cabin, and we had gone to the same high school. Now, as I said, we went 2 days on the ship, and he, being an inveterate traveler, knew immediately how to pack and unpack. And so they had little places where you could put your clothes out. I was, as I always do, I work out of my valise. I go to a hotel, I always work out of my valise. I never use the, I bet you most of you do, right? Well, I didn't. Because the cabin is too small, you got to do something. I can't keep picking up the valise because it's behind the door. You couldn't maneuver. So I go through it, and lo and behold, I come across one of the main reasons why I've gone on this trip. Obviously, for the geographical nature of going to the pole, for me, it was a great, great success, a great joy to consider. But the other one was to celebrate this great book of mine that took almost 10 years to produce. And so I had one of my fellows waterproof a cover, and I was going to dink it at the pole. Thank you. Okay, I take this little thing out. I'm unpacking my stuff. I show him the picture. And the guy, Donald Duncan, responds by saying, "Oh, my God, you won't believe it." I said, "I won't believe what?" He said, "Well, my mother went to Morris High School." Oh, well, that's interesting. That Morris High School. How many people went to Morris High School? Raise your hand. Anyone here? Oh, got one guy. Good. Well, my mother went to Morris High School. Well, that's not unusual. It was the grandmother of all the high schools of the Bronx, so it makes sense. Okay, and my mother worked there for 40 years. 40 years? Yeah, she was known as the Angel of Morris High School. The Angel of Morris High School. Yeah, they named the auditorium after her. Do you remember Duncan Hall? Yes, Duncan Hall. I knew it very well. I'm like stunned by what he's describing here. He then tells me, my book basically ends about 1905 when the new building opens up. His mother began that day that the building opens up. When she began. It was too much for me. I walked away from him. I went to dinner. I didn't see him that night. I mean, he's sleeping when I came back. But it was bothering me all night. So the next day in the morning, I take him aside and I say, "You got to be truthful here. Let's be very straight about this stuff. Did you know who I was? Did you know I'm Mr. New York History? No. Come on now, don't lie to me. Did you know I write all these books, I give these talks and lectures, I go around? Did you know anything about it? No. Come on, you're telling me you didn't know about Morris High School, the book? No. So let me get this straight. They finally allow, the Russians allow people to go to the North Pole using a borrowed Russian nuclear icebreaker. And somehow you and I get forced together in the same cabin and 32 years apart, we went to the same high school. And then you're telling me your mother was the Angel of Morris High School. What does it all mean? Well, for my wife, she was very clear. She said it was meant to be. The guardian angel was with you. And maybe that was it, because the weather was wonderful. The ice wasn't as thick as it could be. The Russians got along. Everybody got along. In fact, all that went said it was one of the grandest times they'd had, one of the most decent times they ever had. Now, the other thing about Mr. Duncan was that Mr. Duncan had rules. He established rules of getting along. I said, "Fine, you have your rules, I have mine. So go ahead, you go first." So his first rule was that everything on the left side is yours and on the right side is mine. Well, you think about that. That's actually a very good idea. So the bed on the left was mine, and that little cover over there, and my toothbrush is on the left. Great idea. Actually, it worked. I tried it at home. It didn't last 5 minutes. But it remains a very good idea. The second thing is, I sleep in the nude, he says. I said, "I couldn't care less. You could take your skin off for all I care." "All right, you ready for mine?" He said, "Yes." Number one, no smoking. "Oh, no problem. I stopped smoking 10 years ago." Great, great, great. Number two, the porthole has to remain open the entire trip. He's a good man. He left it open the entire trip. Now, it was cracked a little smaller at the pole, but there was always air coming in to his freezing body wrapped around because he wouldn't wear his clothes. The great bell in front of the Yamal, this is only a couple hours before the before that we reached the pole, and there's the book I was talking about, Morris High School. What do you mean what I did? Well, let's take a look. Here I am throwing it over the bow of the ship, the cover. I'm anointing it. I am completing my appointed task. And in fact, soon after that, I then threw over an empty bottle of mineral water. And I filled it up so I could get some North Pole water. And I was stopped by a Russian seaman. Luckily, it wasn't an officer. And he came over and he went, "What? What? Do what?" And I, because I was using their rope over the side. So I had to pull it up to show him, and he did in the inimitable style, a universal style around the world. He went like this, and I continued. He made like I was crazy, and I continued, and to this day, I've made little vials of North Pole water that I give out to kids. Big kids, little kids, I give them out. And that particular thing I brought home, of course, with me, my cover, because I had accomplished my appointed task. And so, what concludes this kind of trip better than to see the North Pole Pole returning to its ship as we depart on this great journey to the world that we have today? And I thank you for your attention. I'll be happy to answer any questions if you have. The pole was anywhere between, in the morning it was, as I said, it was a blizzard, so it was about 10 degrees Fahrenheit. With the sun, it was about 25, and the sun was up, about 25 degrees. No, it was not very cold. It's not like the, it's not winter, and it's not like Antarctica. Why don't we put on the big lights, because I can't see with that. Oh, it gets brighter on its own. Okay.
How long did the trip take and what period of time?
July 12th is when we made it. We began about July 2nd, came back on the 22nd.
How much did the trip cost you?
A fortune.
July to what?
July 22nd. This is blinding. What else?
Certified people running a nuclear...
Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely. The Russians, the Russian Navy. Oh, yeah, they weren't fooling around. Now, the other thing, that there was a platform that we used to meet on every once in a while. It turned out it wasn't until afterwards we found out that it was, whereas this was supposed to be a peaceful ship, obviously an icebreaker, every Russian ship had a platform for an ICBM. And in fact, this ship, when it was first built, had one. But they pulled it out. They had the silo right there. The Cold War was only a couple of years ago. And that's why the Russians loved talking with us, because they knew where we were standing.
How was the ship when they broke the ice?
Very noisy.
And
extraordinarily noisy.
Bounce?
I wouldn't say, it was a bounce to it. But as I said, it was like a train, a very bumpy train ride, taking the Amtrak down south. You know, the old Southern Line, going to New Orleans, you know, really rickety like that. I loved it. I loved that movement. I slept like a baby. And with that porthole open, I was a happy man.
Terry, the ship actually breaks the ice, or do they have blades?
No, the ship, the prow of the ship busts through. It's very formed, so that just busts right through. Anyone else? What's that?
Lover.
It was fine food. I didn't trust it. I brought food with me. I brought miso soup packages, enough to last 14 days. It turned out I never had to use them, because the food was fine, it was okay. The Russians had their own food, which we occasionally tried. It was fine as well. They're very, like most navies, the good navies, they really take care of the seamen, and the food is always plentiful. They take care of their people. It's a very hard effort that they have there. Now, in the summer, it isn't, but they showed pictures of what it was like, and they would describe how miserable it was. What a terrible kind of way to live and work. You know, with thick ice, they're constantly pounding the ship to break the ice up. I mean, the ice on the ship, not the ice that they're going through.
You get dressed up in layers of clothes?
All the time, yeah. Especially when you went on the helicopter, because you could break through. If you broke through, you have to be very careful. One night, around 4 a.m., I found myself in the bow of the stern of the ship in the helicopter area. Nobody was there. It looked like 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Sun was bright. It was just glorious. And the ship lurched, went through a tough piece of ice, and it lurched. And I made my way towards the side of the ship, and there's no barriers. This is not like a little cruise ship down in, you know, you're going to the Cancun. This is not like that. And I realized as I'm going like this, well, what happens now? If I'm over, no one will know I'm gone for, 12 hours maybe? And there are a lot of polar bears around. Boy, I'm meat. That's what I have. Luckily, I stabilized, and I went to bed at that point and said I was done for the evening. The point of it all is that it's up to us to make our own time in our own place. These Russians need a desperate for money. We went out of the mysterious port of Murmansk. This is the largest, or was the largest city in the world above the Arctic Circle. And it was an unknown city because one of the great Russian armies was based out of there, and the great naval fleet. They still have the submarine fleet there. And no one ever went there. It was a secret city. It had 1 million people. It looked like Co-op City. Block after block of these disgusting 30-story buildings. Unbelievably bad looking. And now it has less than 400,000 people because when the USSR went down, we found out that they were giving double pay if anyone stayed up there. Double pay, and they gave them an apartment. As soon as the USSR went down, that was it. They had to pay for the apartment, and it was a single pay, and they cut that as well. So people were leaving. And of course, the army was moving out. The USSR had the greatest standing army, even bigger than China. I mean, they had a tremendous army. And now they just let them go. People are wandering around. This is the great fear now, is we have to buy up all their bombs, and we better keep doing it, or someone else is going to be doing it. What's that? Well, the submarines are still there. They keep them up. But right next to the Russian icebreaker fleet, and where our ship was, they told us not to take any pictures, because right next to the ship was a little pocket battleship, let's call it a cruiser, and a small, I guess you can call it an aircraft carrier, a very small aircraft, in terrible shape, rusted, but they were only like 5 years old. They can't keep anything up. They're in terrible shape. So that's why they would rent their equipment. Their best equipment, they're renting to people to get the cash. They need the cash. And in fact, they would go out of their way to try, after they got friendly enough and they realized they could ask because it was against the rules, we were told later, they would try and sell, T-shirts and trinkets, Russian little things. No one would even bother with it. It was all garbage stuff, but they wanted cash. They can get cash. We were told all this in advance to keep away from it. But Murmansk was one of the more disgusting, it was disgusting places. It had no paint. There's no flowers. We're in the middle of the summer. There's no flowers. Nobody plants it. The people were depressed. The place was depressed. It was bad. Bad. And you could see they're just running away from it. As opposed to some of the little towns in Norway, which are also above the Arctic Circle. Norway, how many people have been to Norway? Anybody been to Norway? It's a wonderful place. Wonderful people. And they understand the Russians so well. They don't fear the Russians. They've lived with them for 1,000 years. And of course, their ancestors were the Vikings. So they have a long view of this. And their places are pretty. They have pretty high. They have all their roofs are different colors. And they make sure there's some light and color in their lives and flowers. It was very interesting, the tableau of how it was all established. And to get out of Murmansk was very difficult. You had to go through a lot of red tape for no reason other than they just wanted to bother you. Yes? Well, there's clearly a real polar shift. Now, you have to really define what we're referring to. If we say, would the ice melt? You want to go for that? Or you want to say that the poles change? Because there are a lot of pieces to this. First off, understand that at one time, the area of the North American area, in fact, where we are, really connects to the Atlas Mountains of Morocco. And South America joins up. It was all one great continent called Gondwanaland. And Antarctica fit in under the bottom, along with Australia. And then it broke up. And this happens periodically. This is about 200 million years ago, when it broke up and separates. And eventually we come back together again. So the pole, which probably had ice as far as we know, but then didn't have land, now it has land. And that's why they find fossils in Antarctica. Now keep in mind, Antarctica, when you go to the South Pole in Antarctica, okay, the South Pole is located on land, and you're 10,000 feet up above. It's 2 miles worth of ice at the South Pole. At the North Pole, where you saw me standing, I was standing 10,000 feet of water above land. Very similar. 10,000 feet above sea level. Except I was considered sea level, and the South Pole is considered 10,000 feet above sea level. So it's a dimple effect. But it's basically all the same. It's like an obloid of what the area is. The poles themselves cannot really shift. If the poles truly shift, then they will change the speed at which the world moves. If that happens, our gravity changes, and if that occurs, we lose our atmosphere. And we're long gone, so it don't make a difference about us. And then all we'll be left is those microbes deep in the earth. Well, it's conceivable it could go like that. I mean, anything is possible. Yeah, that's one of the rumors. Keep in mind that when the reptilian age ended, they're still not sure what happened, but they think it could have been a meteor that went into the Yucatan. They seem to see a giant depression there. And when we have had great volcanoes, like Krakatoa in the 1880s, it actually clouded up the Earth's atmosphere for years. Imagine something so immense. The Yucatan is very large, a very large area, that it would blow up stuff and debris, change the temperatures, but at the same time, stop the great sun to come through. There's no photosynthesis, nothing's growing. Well, plants and seeds can last for some years, and then they come back. But meanwhile, what are the creatures eating? What's happened? So there's vast die-offs. And that's the problem you've heard of nuclear winter, things of that nature with nuclear bombs. We're not sure what'll happen. But clearly, this is a very delicate affair. The envelope that surrounds the Earth, the atmosphere, is a very thin layer. Very thin layer. About 100 miles is its further extent. And without it, nothing lives that is aerobic. Not anaerobic, aerobic.
When's the next trip and where are you going?
Well, clearly, I got to go to the South Pole.
Excellent. I recommend it very well. Thank you very much. I hope you'll appreciate it.
Thank you. You went to the South Pole?
Harry, I'm there 5 months.
You were one of the South Poles within 8 years.